So how are we gonna do the intro here?
Like we usually do.
Not good.
Sure.
Okay. So, hi, welcome
hi.
To Monster Vlogs. I'm Charlie.
I'm Haley.
And we just saw The Old Dark House, which doesn't have a monster in it.
It just has people.
It just has Boris
it's
Karloff.
It's an old creepy house with a bunch of crazy people.
Boris Karloff is in it. The guy who plays the mad scientist in Bride of Frankenstein is in it. We've been building up Bride of Frankenstein for a good long while.
We kinda have.
We better like have a Godzilla-sized vlog about Bride of Frankenstein where you do most of the talking.
No, you're gonna do talking too.
I know, but it seems to be your baby. Anyway, Old Dark House. I'm just gonna go out on a limb here. This is probably the creepiest, most effective horror movie from Universal that we have seen up until this point.
More than Dracula?
More than Dracula.
More than Frankenstein?
More than Frankenstein. And more than Murders in the Rue Morgue.
Care to back up your argument?
Okay. Like, there were scenes in here that you would normally expect to see in modern-day horror movies, where just, like, there's different camera angles, a whole lot of different sounds, use of mirrors that distort images, and just the quick-paced cutting of it all. That scene is put in this movie to kind of lure you into the madness of this house.
This is definitely not just like, you know, monster happens, monster gets sicked on community, community defeats monster. This is a haunted house kind of horror. And it was almost psychological because there's no actual ghost. There's just people have been driven to this house full of crazy people by a storm and have to deal with that. And it's like all over the course of one rainy night.
Oh, I love a rainy night. Dun, 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 dun. Why'd I break that out? But yeah.
And
the use of shadow, because there's a scene where character names don't really matter. The main girl character,
the wife character,
is making shadow puppets, and I'm like, okay,
it's so cute because I would totally do that.
And she's like on like one side of the screen.
She's by herself in the room, and it's like the living
in
room,
the dining
room,
yeah.
room area, and there's this huge fireplace behind her, and so it's like this, she has this huge shadow on the wall, and she just starts doing shadow puppets, which is totally
and like a little bit of shadow play. And she's only on one side of the screen, and I'm like, okay, where's the other shadow gonna come in? Is
and
it gonna
the
come in from
shadow,
the side?
Like,
nope, comes out from behind her. Ooh.
It's like the shadow morphs, the shadow of the old woman morphs out of the shadow of the young girl, and it's like freakish and awesome and cool.
I don't think I was expecting it to be this creepy.
It's definitely like more atmospheric and psychological than a lot of what we've been dealing with before.
Yeah,
minimalistic atmosphere and. Like, it's all just, like, in people's heads and just...
I mean, because the way that...
This is ahead of its time, really.
Slightly, yeah. And, but just the way, because I follow James Rolfe, Angry Video Game Nerd. I know, big shocker. But he does, like, the Monster Madness videos every year, ever since 2007. And during the second... which I think was in 2010, he covered Old Dark House, and he made it seem like a light romp of a light-hearted, kind of cheesy Universal horror movie.
Really
no!
I mean...
No! I mean, maybe the acting, but that was the acting of the day anyway.
But it even felt like, just with the people that had to run to the house because of the storm, like, they were... I'm sitting on his feet.
Yeah, don't let me distract you.
Much better. Thank you, dear.
You're welcome.
And, you know, it was... It kind of had that all-in-a-locked-room sort of feeling. It was very claustrophobic.
Oh, it was.
And they had to learn,
like,
to tolerate each other and just...
This was the epitome of a bottle movie.
Very much a bottle movie. Like, very few sets, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, but it all takes place in the one house. Outside of, like, getting there.
Mm-hmm. And it's, like, this married couple and their kind of former soldier poet friend who come in. And then it's this
Quasimodo and his sugar mama, or not sugar
it's
mama.
It's the sugar dad. He's the sugar daddy. And a chorus girl. And that's a whole different relationship than you think. We'll get to that in a minute. And then they come in, and to this house that's, like, owned by this brother.
Off the beaten path.
This crazy, like, old house off a map, owned by this old, crazy brother and sister.
Brother, sister, father, and
father,
other,
and manservant.
And manservant. Or are we not? The movie is, like, 80
years
old.
I know. We'll get to him later.
Okay.
But let's talk about that family for a minute there.
I made mention of this to you before. I love that, because usually in haunted house movies, obviously the tenants of the house are the ghosts. But
there's no ghosts in this one.
No, there's
technically,
just
there's just
a
the
bunch
ghosts
of crazy
of the,
people.
The ghosts of the mind, as it were.
Yeah, but I really loved how, because the main sort of proprietor of the place, the
Charles Lawton.
No. That was the sugar daddy. The guy who played the mad scientist in Bride of Frankenstein. He's, like, the main sort of lord of the house, and he comes off as more legitimately afraid to live there. And his sister...
he's spooked by his own shadow.
And his sister's more like, eh.
His sister's one of those bitter old people that hate fun and blame God because they hate fun.
Almost one of those soothsayer kind of, like, women.
I mean,
like, old...
Like
one of those...
if you hate fun, be honest about hating fun. Don't say you hate fun because of God. Just say you hate fun.
I use that term right. Soothsayer?
Soothsayer is like a fortune teller.
Yeah, she's like one of those, like...
She
comes off as, like, a soothsayer to me, whereas, like, she... Well, not obviously in, like, the Wiccan or Santerian arts, but, you know, just sort of like how she's the one who kind of foreshadows everything and, like, don't do this! It's terrible!
And she's very, like, critical of youth. Because one day, like, she tells the wife character, like, you know,
you're
wicked because you're young and you're pretty, basically, is her deal.
You hear that? You hot women out there?
You're wicked and heathen because
you're
young and you're pretty, and that ain't gonna last, sister. That's her whole deal. Like, I cannot stand those people, because there's, like, no... It's a pet peeve of mine, just for people to be like, I don't like you because...
You're young.
You're you, basically. And it's like, you
everything
know,
about you?
It's like, okay, so I'm born unholy, how do I fix this? And I like it even less when those people blame it on God, because that's completely non-wrong.
Was she blaming it on God, or was it...
I say blaming it on God, but I really mean using her perversion of belief to justify her prejudices.
Yeah, this was very much, like, now that you mention that, this was very much a Westboro Baptist Church kind of mentality.
I mean, I wouldn't say that, because she's too... She's not actively judgmental. She's just gonna sit there and just judge you. I'm judging you for laughing right now.
Like, I'm
totally judging you for smiling right now.
I'ma die anyway,
so... I'm judging you for being fun.
I'm old.
That is that kind of person. It's like, they're not, like, actively saying, I hate you. It's actively saying, what you do is worthless, and I'm just gonna sit here and stew about it. I am so freaking austere in how I live my life. Anything, like the color, anything that is not black and gray and white is stupid. It's like an old Dutch Presbyterian dance.
Okay, but then there was...
Truth in television, my great-grandmother was kind of like that. Like, the Dutch one, Like, she was one of those people that hated fun, and she drove my great-grandfather to drink, and that's... that's like, the few memories my mother has of my great-grandmother are that kind of old, judgmental woman who hates fun.
You know what?
And I think that's why I don't like this character so much.
Well, now that I think about it, she was, like, the one praise, like, you know, like... Oh, we have to say grace before ever the she's like the Uber.
Like, she's like you must say grace before this meal. And
the fundamentalist Christian, if you will.
Pet peeve of mine, huge pet peeve of mine is people who insist upon saying grace and then like rattle off in the quickest, most monotone way this memorized, unfeeling, just completely just like lifeless prayer. Like that, like, it's yeah. Like, okay, if you're gonna insist on grace, mean it when you say it, okay?
I mean, granted, that's probably more Catholic household or a Catholic thing.
Anglican. Ooh. It was in England, baby.
Okay.
But they have they have the Book of Common Prayer too. So.
But now that you mention it, she does, and now that I think about it, she's like wanting to say grace and all that, and yet she's the quickest, sloppiest eater where everyone is so prim and proper.
She eats like an old country woman. And she's like...
Like just the very way she eats is
almost like... Elbows on the table, shoveling it in.
And like taking those pickled onions and just like piling them on her plate.
It's like this, it's, you know, it's clearly no thought to the food. When that's what grace is thinking about where this food comes from, being grateful about it. And especially, like, in England, you're supposed to have the best table manners around guests. And it was just, like, it made the dinner scene so uncomfortable. And there was very, like, no music in this. And I think that was deliberate.
Yeah, no music in it. But unlike Dracula, it had better pacing.
It did. And it, well, they had a bit more years on them. And I feel like
made...
It made the beginning more awkward and uncomfortable, and it made the third act more tense and
scary. Yeah. And then there's Boris Karloff's character.
Who is mute and drunk most of the time.
And as even the mad scientist guy in Bride says, dumb. He straight out says, this butler is dumb.
Dumb is another word for mute in that day and age.
Oh. I am enlightened. Accidentally stupid once again. But I'm dumb. But
he was just like, just kind of, he was Lurch.
He wasn't Lurch. He was straight up Frankenstein again.
Lurch looks like Frankenstein's monster.
I understand that, but he was the Frankenstein monster all over again.
But there was no pathos with Morgan. Like, I felt for Frankenstein's monster. Morgan was just like, Lurch, and just, you rang.
Well, because at the beginning of this movie, there is a huge disclaimer, a producer's note saying, Boris Karloff is in this. Yes, he was the monster in Frankenstein. He's basically the same character.
Only much less sympathetic.
Only much less sympathetic, because apparently if you have a sympathetic character versus a non-sympathetic character, that's wide range in acting. Old Hollywood kind of sucked here. Jess, do this movie some justice, okay?
You better link to her.
I will. If I remember.
I'll remind you.
But there's really no sort of depth to this character until Saul is introduced.
Yes. Saul is the typical crazy uncle in the attic.
He is freaking... He's almost like Norman Bates up in here. Like, he like, quotes the Bible with a knife in his hand and threatening to chuck it at the dude.
And he does chuck it at the dude.
And homeboy's a pyromaniac. He straight up grabs a log from the fire and starts setting things on fire.
Laughing insanely. Like, he's just high-pitched, freaky giggle. And
taking joy in destruction. That is... Wow, that's... Like, that he's almost Joker and Norman Bates rolled into one.
I would say that. Because he's very soft-spoken, but he just, like, gleefully runs off and destroys things.
Oh, man.
And the entire, like, the only person who really talks to Saul is the soldier character.
Yeah.
Who really talks to him alive, because everyone else is either stuffed in a cupboard hiding or locked out in the kitchen area.
Because, I mean, his appearance is, like, very built up to, and you expect him to look crazy.
You expect him to look worse than Morgan, who has this, like, huge...
Like beard Grizzly on him, Adams and then, like, scars all over his face.
But he just looks like a little tottery old man.
Tottery old man until he, like, until, goes crazy and, until like, gets that he, look he lets
the
face.
Crazy out. Because he keeps the crazy in for a little bit, and then he lets the crazy out.
Yeah.
And it's really freaky.
And then, like, Morgan sort of has this sympathy towards him after he dies. Spoiler, he dies. Haze Code, ooh.
Like, Morgan...
This is going to be a running gag, like, was the Haze Code in effect? Yes, it was.
Like, Morgan's doing this lurchy thing, because he has a thing for the wife character. He's, like, this typical, you know, he men want woman, lurch want woman.
Lurch didn't want women, though. No, he just wanted to serve the Adams family lurch as was best cool. as he can.
Lurch was cool. Lurch didn't deserve to be compared to Morgan. He's anti-Lurch. He's anti-Lurch.
I actually heard that Lurch in the Raul Julia movies was actually played by Jared's uncle.
Neat.
Yeah. I could be Who wrong. Knows? I'm going to cut this out if I'm wrong.
Okay. But anti-Lurch, because that's what I'm calling him now, he's like, goes toward the women, and then she's like, no, I have to take care of Saul. And he's like,
Saul?
No!
Saul!
And he just, like, picks up the guy and carries him up the stairs.
Like, up the stairs, all sad, like sees people right next to him, doesn't care.
It's, so, like, obviously the one person in the world he cares about. And apparently this kind of crap only happens when he's drunk. When he's sober, he's just, like, he's regular Lurch. But when he gets drunk, he's anti-Lurch.
He's, like, smashing through windows and, like, wanting to rape women and... You know, look, unlocking doors that shouldn't be unlocked because the 100-year-old man up in his bedroom.
And then there's the invalid dad in the situation.
The invalid dad, played by a woman with a mustache and beard. It looked like a woman. It sounded like a woman. I don't know.
We're going to put the name down there, and if he's wrong, give him a mustache.
Me a mustache? Yes. I don't... You want to give me...
Twirly handlebar mustache.
I'm going to stay still so I can animate that on myself.
Yay!
Because, yeah, okay. Yeah, anyway. But, okay. I think we're kind of, like, is there any deeper meaning into this? Don't go into creepy old houses in the rain.
I like that it kind of brought the younger people together. Like, it brought the married couple together. They were all bickering in the car before him, but then they were like, oh, darling, afterwards.
Yeah.
And, I really love the relationship between the rich sugar daddy character and the chorus girl. Because you think, like, you think you know what's up when they come in. It's like this rich, older, heavier guy and this young girl.
But, yeah, that guy is played by Charles Slaughton. And he was actually Quasimodo in another adaptation of Hunchback of Notre Dame. The Paramount one. The 1940 version of it. But,
like, you know, he's actually someone who made all his money... Because people made fun of his wife and then she died. And he's actually this really lonely, unfulfilled guy. And he really just, you know, the chorus girl just so he has someone to talk to.
Yeah.
And they have this really sweet, very platonic, that purposefully doesn't look platonic, but it's a platonic relationship. And, you know, she doesn't resent him at all. She's like, he's a nice guy. I respect him, and I feel bad for him. He's a good friend. And she,
I don't love him, but I'll stick around with him.
But yeah, because he's a nice guy. But the chorus girl falls in love with the soldier guy, and they tell the businessman that, and he has this, like, very respectful relationship with her. Like, I think you're crazy for running off with him, but I'm happy for you.
Like,
he's not sad. He's like, yay, my friend found love. Okay. And like, secretly, he's just, like, really happy for him.
Happy for them, but he doesn't show it. Like, I would say that's more Irish or Scottish or whatever accent that... I wouldn't have leaned towards Scottish.
I don't even
Maybe
know
Welsh.
What that accent was. But, you know, he's
but,
just...
like, right at the end when the soldier guy proposes to the chorus girl, you could see him in the back. You don't see his, like, any of his torso. You just see his legs. And they immediately cross up and go, Like, good on you, director of James Wells. Good on you.
Whale. I think it was Whale.
James Wallace.
Whale. We'll figure it out. But yeah, like he even stands guard over the soldier guy and the chorus girl.
Has
the just huge fire poker that looks like a spear.
Fire poker, hat, coat. Yes.
I'm protecting my friends. Like, you gotta know that after that movie was over, that entire group just goes out for drinks every so often. Like, yeah.
Probably.
Like, we survived a thing.
The morning after. So, there wasn't really any deeper meaning. Why do you think there were all those psychological mishaps in the...
Because
there was mention of... This is definitely a post-World War I movie... As the soldier guy is...
Because it does talk about that he was in the war and he's of the tainted generation, it's like.
Uh-huh.
And there's a lot of old versus young in this.
Like everybody in that house is old, and dark house.
Yeah. And, like, everyone in that house has kind of survived over from the Edwardian period when there was... Or even the Victorian period, considering it was the early 30s. And they looked in about their 70s,
mm-hmm.
70s or 80s. And so they would have, like, been in the prime of their life in the late 1800s when all that gothic Victorian stuff. And yes, I watched the first episode of Penny Dreadful.
I mean, by the time this comes out, it'll be episodes later.
They dealt with this whole other just aristocratic intrigue and madness. And it seemed like there was this whole story about that family that we were just walking in on the end of. And it was the new generation with their interwar problems and aftermath of World War I problems.
Do you have the hiccups?
I have slight hiccups, but I'm trying to make a point here. And their problems, which are legitimate, but these people that come from this old, dark history, history and house, are just clashing with. Because they keep getting paired up with each other. Like, the old woman clashes with the young wife. The old caretaker man clashes with the husband. Saul clashes with
the soldier.
And it's this feeling like there's... Because the young have their problems, the old are their problems, and when they get together,
they sort of have an understanding.
And
like the old kind of seeks solace in the young, except for the crazy old lady. She's the one that condemns everyone on the spot. Whereas
I feel like the old man.
The old man is really more man, just afraid.
He's afraid, and he's willing to chuck someone under the bus for him to get away. He's the one that that will trip you, zombies get you first.
He's the survivalist.
The old woman just blames everyone else.
Saul is just crazy, and Morgan is...
The old man is just, I'm ready to die, I don't care.
I'm gonna die.
Literally, like, I've reached the end of my life, and I'm so old, I do not care. Someone get me a new pair of Depends.
Depends, I think. Get me a coffin. Get me a coffin so I can resurrect myself, because this is a universal horror movie. Might as well become a vampire. Old enough to look like one.
Yeah, and it's this feeling of, you know, new kids with problems inheriting old problems, and how as you are, I once was, as I am, you will be, which is a quote from Canterbury Tales.
That's a very common...
And that I feel like that's a kind of theme.
A very common headstone quote. Because
it's of a corpse talking to a young man.
And, you know, and when Saul is unleashed, the old woman is like, the sins of the father, the sins of the father! And then locks everyone in.
Out.
Yeah. Lexa locks everyone out. So... Would this be horrifying to an audience in 1930-something?
I think so.
1932.
I think so. Especially
if I found it creepy
in the First World War.
If I found it creepy, oh yes.
And it's definitely creepy to an audience today. Because we were creeped out by it.
If you can, like, appreciate this, because... I mean, obviously you need to have an eye towards that. You can't just go into this, you know, being a fan of the Saw series because you'll fall asleep.
It's a different kind of horror.
Yeah.
But if you like stuff that has a lot of, like, Insidious, the kind that's, you know, stuff that's in the corner and there's little music and it's a very quiet version of that.
Oh, yeah.
I like it. I think if you are a person that likes more psychological, quiet horror, you know, this, I would definitely recommend this. There are some great, like, some fabulous scenes.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that director is just, because, you know, just with the light shining down on the monster in Frankenstein when he was in the chair, to, like, all those, like, the shadow shot, the, like, quick cuts with the old lady talking. I think this is probably my favorite horror director. One of my favorite horror directors. James Wells, just...
Thank you, sir.
You're dead. You're dead, but... So, what did Haley draw today?
In the vein... I've drawn another vampy woman. This time in a crazy ornate dress.
I see that you got the back of a rib cage right there.
Yeah, I did like a spine pattern in the back of the lace. So.
Oh, that is the lace?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Very good, honey. Thank you.
Next time.
Again, I mean, you can make suggestions whenever you want, but...
We'll totally get to the comments
if
when we get caught up, so please make them. We love your feedback.
Please, comments, watch these movies. Please.
We know you're watching, we would just like some feedback.
I know.
Don't beg, it's undignified.
I'm not begging. Anyway.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Wrong monster. That's not So, if you like this video, no, you're not allowed to be in it anymore. If you like this video, please by all means like leave a comment, share it, subscribe by clicking our faces. Tumblr it, Facebook it.
Yeah. All the stuff.
Last time we tackled the murders in the Rue Morgue with Bela Lugosi.
Mm-hmm. Somewhere around here is our special Godzilla one.
No, the special Godzilla one is... Do you really want to leave a special Godzilla one after that?
Well, I'm just saying, we have a vlog on Godzilla that we might want to link to.
Event? This is coming out weeks and weeks after Godzilla.
Okay, fine.
Because we did Godzilla, like, last night.
It's fresh on the brain.
I know. So, yeah. Murders in the Rue Morgue. Next time...
Mummy!
We are revisiting Boris Karloff, and he gets to talk!
He gets to talk.
He gets to talk and walk and be threatening, and yay, more... makeup artist guy.
Jack Pierce
makeup. Yay. Oh man, this is one I've seen before. Have you seen it before?
I've seen all but the end.
Okay, you are going, the end is okay. You're gonna have to go on and on and on about the end, and of course we're gonna make comparisons to the Steven Summers movie,
of course,
which is inevitable, but prepared for this is one of the bigger ones.
It's gonna be fun.
Yeah. Okay, we've had a couple weeks of like non-monster vlogs, but we're getting back on track. This is a mummy. This is not only a mummy, this is the mummy.
Oh yeah.
Peace.